Welcome back to our October 7th, 2020 Coral Springs Charter School Board Meeting. Deb, if we could do roll call again, please.
Certainly. Chair Vignola.
Here.
Board Member Brooke said he'd join us in a few minutes. Board Member Sarah. He's here.
Yeah, I'm present.
Okay. Board Member Simmons. Board Member Carter.
I'm present.
Thank you. Deputy City Manager Heller.
Present.
City Manager Babinick.
Here.
Thank you. City Attorney Hearn.
Here.
And then, Mr. Hearn, do we have to do the virtual statement again, or we're good because we're continuing?
No, this is a continuation of our meeting. Okay. You can go straight into where you were.
All right, thank you. Ms. Heller. Mrs. Heller.
Okay, good morning again. This is where we left off. The information that I've shared with you this morning is intended to educate you on these options, talk about the pros and cons. Different choices are right for different students. And if there's no question on the comparison data, I would like to, in the interest of time, turn it over to Principal Springer, who has some additional information to share.
Actually, I do. So the AP exam pass rate of 23%, that means of the 104 kids that took the AP exam to charter last year, 80 of them failed that exam and did not get the AP credit for it. That's a significant amount. And when you look at Pembroke Pines chart, I know that was brought up earlier, they're at a 55% pass rate, and Somerset is at a 59% pass rate. So that's something to keep in mind. And look, when we talk about the tests and whatever, there's a lot of other factors with that. If a kid gets sick, or they have a bad day, or they have a headache or a toothache, that exam does carry a lot of weight. And in our little breaks, I spoke to people at two different educational facilities, both of which are private schools on the higher end. And they said that they will not accept the GPA boost for taking an AP exam unless they actually send in those test scores. So I just wanted to correct that. And then, does any of the members of the board have any questions on this slide or anything before we go over to Mr. Springer? Seeing none, Mr. Springer, floor is yours.
Just to address that slide particularly, I mean, there's always qualifiers with regards to that, and I'm going to turn it over to the team in a second, but we are obviously not an AP school, whereas not a wealth of our courses, i.e. even the, if there is such a thing, the easier AP courses. So when you qualify that, you're looking at some of the toughest AP courses that are offered. When we talk about AB, BC, Calc, chemistry in one instance, and then and some other things. So that those are the courses that where our kids, unfortunately, we absolutely need to do better, but whereas they're not passing. So if we were to kind of tease it out a little bit more and compare it to the past rates, I still think we would most likely be a little bit lower, but it wouldn't be as a significant of a gap, because at the other schools, you're looking at all of the AP courses. And for us, you're talking about just a few subjects. So with that said, I'm going to turn it over to Mrs. Weisbaum, Ms. Hu, and Ms. Pepe. I know she's going to jump on, so go ahead, Ms. Weisbaum. We're going to go through a swift pace with regards to this, so as to not repeat what's already been delivered by Ms. Heller, Mrs. Heller, and we really appreciate that. So go ahead, Mrs. Weisbaum.
Everyone, I'll be sharing my screen.
And just hand your slides. Can you guys send them to the city ahead of time so we have a chance to review them and post them? I would appreciate it. Thank you.
Absolutely. Good morning, everyone. We're going to go through some of the advanced programs that we offer here at Coral Springs Charter School. And as Mr. Springer shared, we'll do our best to through some of the information that's already been shared. Some of the advanced programming that's offered at Coral Springs Charter School by state mandate and to provide college and career readiness, we see that each of our graduates has an accelerated point, whether that be through our Cambridge program, our AP courses, or our CTE, which Ms. Hu's gonna speak about in a minute. And this also impacts our school grade calculation. Mrs. Heller offered earlier the number of advanced placement courses we have, as well as the Cambridge courses subject offerings. We also have 7 pathways related to our career and technology education, in addition to the opportunity for our students to see executive internship opportunities. So for AP, this was already discussed a bit earlier by Mrs. Heller. These are the subjects that we offer, with chemistry and our English literature and composition course being new to us this year. We do have the opportunity for our students to simultaneously take these AP courses alongside their Cambridge courses. And I do want to point out that 23%, if compared to the global percentage as a whole, is on par with the pass rate for each subject level globally. We're quite near to the global pass rate. Here is just our pass rate by subject for the last few years. Of course, as mentioned earlier, there was an impact of the assessment period. College Board offered the AP tests online this year, which is not something they've done in the past. So the impact of that is something to consider when related to our pass rate. You can see that we do have 100% pass rate in our AP drawing class, and consistently that, along with our 2D art, continues to be our top rate performance. Just by percentage, another visual for the board to see, the pass rate by percentage for each of the courses that we offered in the 2018-19 and 2019-20 school year. And as mentioned earlier by Mrs. Heller, dual enrollment does not have any revenue associated with it. However, AP does. So this slide, which I will, of course, be happy to send the presentation to the board following our meeting, includes the number of tests that are being taken by our AP students in any given year, as well as our FTE equivalent, which is additional funding, the average revenue that we see, as well as the cost that we are spending. Any questions on the AP? Okay, we're gonna go ahead and speak about our ACE diploma. The Cambridge International Program that we offer here at Coral Springs Charter School has 19 courses with multiple exam offerings in any given series. In this case, series refers to the time period that our students test, which is primarily in the May-June months. In 2020, we entered 430 candidates for over 1,400 exams. And in previous years, we have entered our students for approximately 1,100 to 1,200 exams. So this was an increase last year. We do offer AS level courses with the opportunity to continue to A level or A2 level courses, which is what it is considered in England with Cambridge International. We do offer pre-ACE courses, so our students do have the opportunity to see the ACE curriculum in their ninth grade year to prepare them for what's to come, and the ability to earn their ACE diploma in 10th, 11th, and 12th grade. As mentioned before, earning the ACE diploma, which is a collection of 7 past classes and 7 past assessments, including the required course global perspectives, awards students with 100% bright features. But it is important to recognize that students do get credits for each exam they take. So even if they don't get the diploma, they still get credit. This just goes ahead and lists how our students earn their diploma, courses in multiple groups across disciplinary subjects, as well as that global perspectives and research course, which is a mandatory course. Just another visual to show what courses we offer here at Coral Springs Charter School. This is public and is distributed to our students. The pass rates for 2020, as listed here, show that we did have 100% pass rate in multiple subjects areas for the June 2020 testing series, which is commendable for our students, all things considered. And just a continuation of that pass rate data. So this breaks down our ACE diploma data, which is what we were speaking about earlier, the percentage of students who've earned their ACE diploma. Speaking to last school year, 63 students had already earned their ACE diploma, which is 27% of the entire senior class, not just Cambridge students. Previously, students were able to earn their Cambridge diploma by the end of their junior year. And so we can see in 2018-19, 70% of our applicants earned it before they even got to their senior year. And in the 1920 school year, we had 95% of our junior applicants that earned. So 95% of junior Cambridge students are coming into their senior year this year, already having earned the Cambridge diploma and that 100% Bright Futures, which has been mentioned.
I'm sorry, the 95% number you're talking about, that's of the kids that took the exams. We know
That's of the applicants, yes, sir.
Right, do we know the number of students compared to that take it their junior year versus their senior year that to qualify for the ACE diploma?
So listed in the center of the slide, 82.5% of the senior applicants earned it. This means that they took those exams in the June series, the situation we were talking about earlier, and found out their results approximately August. And their information, their diploma status was reported to Bright Futures. Of course, we are on the side of positivity and report that we expect those senior students to earn their diploma and therefore to earn the 100% Bright Futures.
The percentage you're talking there of senior applicants that earned it, I understand, and you're saying 113 total students applied, but I'm curious as to the breakdown of the number of students that are juniors that get it compared to seniors.
No, absolutely. In the 2020 graduation data, we had 35 students that were juniors that applied for diploma and 39 students that were seniors that applied for diploma.
35 and 39, but we have a total of 113 total students.
I'm so sorry. My apologies. 63. My apologies. I was reading a different data.
63.
Of our 11th graders.
So of the 113 students that applied for it, 63 were 11th graders.
Right. If you can look right to your eyes on the 2020-21, it shows you that 63 students, which means they were the juniors and they're currently now in their senior year. So out of that 113, that was that group that has already earned. So 5% of them that didn't apply. So yeah, just FYI. So 63 students already going into their senior year. And that's when you compare that, that's over 50% of those that will be on track to have a potential diploma.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, sorry.
To continue, we have our cost revenue analysis. As we mentioned earlier, with our AP, depending on the number of students that are enrolled in and take an assessment, particular revenue by FTE is brought to the school. And then you can see that the cost of the revenue that is spent to run the exams differs from the AP. I'll go ahead and turn it over to Mrs. Donahue to speak to you about career and technology education.
Thanks, Amy. But Mr. Chair, I might just talk a little bit about the Cambridge portion in terms of my own personal experience as a student from a Commonwealth country. Cambridge was actually intended. Pardon?
You can always talk about anything you ever want.
I know that, Mr. Vigil.
You're doing a wonderful job.
No, but I just want to let you know that Cambridge has been around for a very, very long time. And countries that belong to the Commonwealth, we are required to take Cambridge exams. And the idea was that we could actually go to any school in any country. Actually, United States was the only place that we never really was able to get into very easily because they did not recognize Cambridge. So having Cambridge, the idea was that because we were in a global economy, that students could go to Spain, England, wherever they wanted to go for an education. Having done Cambridge, I can tell you, I graduated with 8 to Cambridge for a Cambridge diploma back in my time, and you know how young I am. And that afforded me actually one whole year off my degree. So, that also allowed me to take extra credits to enrich my education in business. So that's how that was used. So, it's a great program and it does provide for the GPA, but also if you have the right courses, you can get an exemption so you can take additional courses to enrich that education. So that's my little speed for Cambridge. I'm a Cambridge girl. On the subject of career and technology, Ms. Weisbaum, could you change the slides for me? I'm just going to go through this. There's a time with the city where, you know, there was some concern that we never provided for students that were not four-year college bound. And the state basically started redesigning the programs and making a lot more things available to us. So the right now, there are two scholarships that are available through our career technical education program, which is really called business and technology education here. The Florida GOC basically says, you know what, we will give you 2 years of an associate degree, 2 years as a bachelor, as long as you're enrolled in a pathway of 3 credit courses, pass an industrial certification in each of those courses, and then you can go on. You can use those industrial certification exams to actually get college credit too. So there is something there for everybody. So even though we might think that a student doesn't take Cambridge or AP, we do advance your education through the Career Technical Education Program. Ms. Weisbaum, thank you. This is a different pathway, which is only for 2 years at the college level, and all they have to do is to take the pathway. They don't even need to pass an industrial certification exam. So it still gives them opportunity to post-secondary education. Next slide, please. Our CT program, you'll notice that we started very early in middle school, and what that has done for us is to actually have them earn a high school credit as well as certify in Microsoft Office. And when they get to high school, it actually frees up a slot on their high school schedule so that they can take additional courses that they'd like at that time. In high school, we offer business management, digital design, digital media, digital video, marketing, and personal trainer. And I'm sure you can relate to this because that's exactly what's in demand right now. These are our pass rates. 2017-18, we passed 274 industrial certifications with a 44% pass rate. 2018, 310, 50% pass rate. And 2019-20, 187, and of course, that's a COVID factor. We're actually on our way to increasing the number of certifications as we increase the number of students being available to take the program. Next slide, please. Thanks. This is our cost effectiveness analysis, and you'll notice that it's 13% of our revenue for 2017-18, 7% of our revenue for 18-19, and 16% for 19-20. And of course, the love of everybody's life at the city of Coral Springs, the ACE Academy, and we've done very well. This is a signature program. And, you know, why it does not have an exam or say money associated with it in terms of revenue back to the school, I can tell you there's a lot that we get from this. We still have our speaker bureau, the Learn and Earn Saturdays ethics seminar. Some of you from the city have participated in this. And the city has also provided us with a lot of internships that have gone a long way with our graduates. We have had more than 400 graduates. Thank you. The benefits, firsthand exposure to working in the real world, giving students a chance to put their knowledge to work, experimental learning, project-based learning, and that's been the focus. You know, students need to be able to do project-based learning because that's the way the real world functions now. They learn new skills, they build confidence, connect with professionals. But more importantly is the fact that, you know, it increases the chances of a college and career internship. It opens the doors to many organizations. Thank you. Intrinsic, 60% of the enrollment are due to referrals. Students refer other students. You know, they're like, you know, you got to get into this program. They're among the top 30% of our graduating class. Satisfaction from our business partners, 95% year after year. They're very pleased with the program. You know, we've got very good kids here. And of course, our partners are always willing to help out. The graduates prove to be college and career ready. They're disciplined, mature, And more important is the fact that the program is recognized in college applications, because it basically means that you have engaged in an adult environment, you have experience with project-based learning, you've done research, you know how to present, and so it's easier for you to get an internship at the college level. If nothing else, we're brand recognized for excellence, I can tell you that much. And of course, here's our video. This is our student. You'll find a lot about him when you see this video.
We're going to bypass this. Unfortunately, okay. It's an incredible video. I want you all to take a look at this. We want to really kind of get to the end, because the entire intent and to the commission in and of itself, you know, you can certainly ask the question to the chair. But I feel like we're trying to give you a whole comprehensive idea and view that we very much have a foundation in place and a very aggressive course offerings for our students. And I think we'll go to the last slide. I think it's one of the last slides on here, Ms. Weisbaum, yeah. If you don't mind. I'm sorry, Ms. Hu. Brandon's phenomenal.
No, that's fine. Him.
I mean, he's got some great feedback about our ACE program. Highly recommend. So this, Ms. Pepe, you want to speak to this?
Okay, so this goes over just a general overview of the financial impact of dual enrollment and an overview of the average number of students who do participate. In summer of 2019, 173 dual enrollment courses were taken by students. So that means that, you know, maybe we had 100 students taking more than one class, but the number of classes taken was 173. The summer 2020 data is a little skewed due to changes made to course offerings. We would have had a lot more participation, but a lot of the classes were either canceled because of COVID, and a lot of them were turned to online only. So we would have expected more classes to be taken, but many were canceled because of that. So if we assume that on average the students enrolled in 100 courses per term, during the fall and the spring, with a cost per credit being around $72. Each course is typically 3 credits. When you multiply that, it's about $215 per course. If we had 100 courses enrolled, it would cost about $21,500 per semester. And when you include the cost of textbooks, which is about $6,000 to $8,000 a semester, you're looking at a total year increase by including fall and spring of about almost close to $60,000. So factors to consider when we're looking at students who qualify for dual enrollment is the workload of the high school and dual enrollment schedule. A lot of our students take a full load of ACE and AP classes here, and many of them, you know, their stress levels are already high. Adding additional classes after school for dual enrollment could impact that. It does, like Ms. Heller had mentioned, it does affect the college GPA, transportation to campus, availability of courses after school hours. So the students would be limited to taking classes after school, which would obviously, dependent on the Broward College schedule of courses, might be limited.
Right, thanks. I think that's it for us. I just wanted to, you know, we were charged with bringing something back to this board. We wanted to provide you as much information as possible on where it goes from here. I'll sit back and pass it back to the chair, Mr. Vignola.
Thank you, sir. Can we pull that last slide up again, please? And while you do that, I just want to go over, I guess, a couple of things. Does any member of the board have any questions regarding the presentations? Board Member Sarah?
Yeah, I'm just looking for clarity. Are we listening to this presentation to get educated on the offerings and the potential direction that the school leadership and Charter USA may go, or are we voting on something? Because in my opinion, I'm very appreciative of this presentation and I've learned a lot, but I'm not sure that that's the role of the board to vote on whether or not we're doing dual enrollment or enhancing the AP. offerings or any of that stuff. So can I get some clarification, please, from the chair or from city manager Babinick or city attorney Hearn?
So my speaking to Mr. Springer, Mr. Babinick, and city attorney Hearn, actually, we do have the authority to set the direction on the educational activities at the school as far as if we go ahead and we allow dual enrollment. I've been told by all three that they will go ahead and make that take place.
What we have on the agenda is a discussion item. So I think, you know, obviously we can provide direction, but it wasn't set up here for a vote. I don't think anyone's expecting that. But direction, as the board chair said.
All right, but then I need further clarification. Direction meaning that they have to do it, or direction meaning that they have to explore it? Because just because of my background, there are many recommendations that are made, but we have always given at least our schools autonomy to make decisions based on what they feel is best for their student body and the community as a whole. So I just need clarification on that, John, if you don't mind. Like direction meaning this is just what they're doing, or direction meaning explore it and make the final decision the way you feel best, but you at least got our input as a board.
Well, for today's purposes, there wouldn't be a vote. So I think at this point my review and understanding of this is we are having a discussion, giving direction, taking back and forth. And maybe there might be something else that comes later. But at this point, I think we need to see really where this board is from what they would prefer, and then get with Charter School USA and we're doing here through a Principal Springer of how we want to move forward. So there's going to be no formal action right now that I was expecting anyway, unless someone disagrees with me. But it's listed as a discussion, so there'd be no vote.
Is that okay, Board Member Sarah?
Thank you, Chair.
All right. Does any other board member have any questions on this? I can't see you all. Okay.
I don't have any questions, Mr. Chair, but my gut tells me, you know, dual enrollment would be a great option. I haven't personally heard of negative experiences regarding dual enrollment. It certainly helped my daughter. We had a neighbor next door who wound up saving 2 years of college because of her dual enrollment. I think my daughter's dual enrollment will save her 1 year of college. So that type of savings and investment, I think, is awesome. So those are the only comments I had. I didn't have questions about the presentation, but I definitely appreciated the presentation.
Thank you. Board Member Simmons, you're not on mute. I don't know if you wanted to speak.
Yeah, I did. I raised my hand. I guess
I can't see all of you at the same time, so I'm like scrolling back and forth on the participants. So I'm trying to.
I guess for me, I'm kind of along the same lines as Chair Member Sarah, as far as just kind of what our role is with this. And I'm not sure if this question has been answered, but maybe I just needed to ask it to understand more simplistically or get like a direct answer. Why is it an either or scenario, or is it not an either or scenario, or are we trying to, you know, give direction for more emphasis on one particular thing? I want to understand, because it seems as if, you know, we have done the AP part really well and things of that nature. But I also know that, you know, my sister, when she actually, she did dual enrollment herself. She was in the Cambridge program at Charter, but then when she went to Diller, she did the dual enrollment. But also not public schools, like, you know, used to have AP classes, dual enrollment, things of that nature. So I'm just trying to understand a little bit more, and I get the presentation and I know why we're meeting, but I guess I just need some direct answers to the question I'm asked, as far as, you know, is this either or, you know, why is it an either or situation?
So what I'm looking at, and this is kind of my item to bring up, is not, I'm not looking to get rid of Cambridge. I think Cambridge is a wonderful program. I think a lot of people choose Coral Springs Charter School for the Cambridge program. And I believe they were one of the first ones in the state of Florida to actually offer it. I know a lot of other schools have gone ahead and tried to push for it. I was the community sponsor for Coral Glades when they put in for it probably 7 or 8 years ago. And a lot of schools want to have that program. It's awesome. This is something that would be in addition to an extra option for students. You know, and I think that's, it's more of that. It's not a either or. We're not saying, what I'm not looking to do is get rid of their AP offerings or their Cambridge offerings. This would be for the kids that wanted more, to go ahead and have that option to do dual enrollment. It's really more what I'm looking for.
May I?
Yes, sir.
So to answer Commissioner Simmons, along with everybody else, just to give you context, we do offer dual enrollment. But we currently only offer it because of the way we feel our course offerings, you know, guide our students throughout the school year. And because there are, is such, as you just saw, such a massive list of offerings, that currently we offer dual enrollment during the summer to our students. So as that they're taking the courses that they normally wouldn't be able to take throughout the course progression during their time in school with us. The commissioner in particular, Mr. Bignola, the chair, is seeking that we would add this in to our term offerings as in the spring or fall. The concern in that instance is that in at a certain point, there's multiple concerns. Number one, in the summer, it costs the school, it's a net cost, right? It's a zero. Here, it's a cost with no ROI. Now, the ROI is on the student, so please, you know, I don't want to be that cold, but there's no ROI. What we had showed you in the other programs that we have, the reason why they're sustainable, the reason why we have a greater level of staffing than we would as compared to other schools, is because those programs support that ability for us to balance our budget. If we were to add in these courses and open it up and provide the opportunity, we would then obviously open it up and the opportunity would have to be available to all that would qualify. And we're just giving you a potential financial impact and cost on this. Since this isn't a vote today, you know, it's just the direction or to vote moving forward on what you would choose for us to do. But the current structure and the identity and the position of the school is to move and continue with what we have just shown you. Dual enrollment also, it was brought up at an earlier meeting in August, I believe, about not allowing students the opportunity from the summer of eighth grade, after eighth grade, rolling into ninth grade. We've had that conversation. I've shared that off to the side with the chair, and we as a school are willing to take into that consideration if the students are of that ability, that they can also, after their eighth grade year in the summer, take a dual enrollment course. The concern for us is also twofold. If you, the one thing we definitely want to avoid is students taking it during the school day, because then we would also, number one, we would lose funding for FTE dollars if we're outside of the instructional minutes being met. Commissioner Sarah is very aware of this. And then we would also, it would be a cost. So it would be on top of it, we would lose some funding, but we would also have to pay for the courses. So we're trying to find that balance. As Ms. Heller had showed, Pembroke Pines Charter has their identity. I think it was Somerset was the other school, has their own identity. So everybody treats this differently. And we were just, you know, looking to kind of move forward how we currently do with the options being available.
So I want to touch base on a few things here, Board Member Simmons, if it's okay. I know you were, okay. So some of my concern with the summer offering, right? The summer offering, if you come from a split home and you have a family member that lives in another area, another state or whatever, and you should go to spend that summer with that other family member, be it mom or dad or whomever, that limits your opportunity for dual enrollment right now, currently. You know, I know we talked about the money for the AP and the Cambridge programs. And yes, it is a revenue generator for the charter school. I believe the charter school makes about $850,000 a year off of our contract with the city of Coral Springs. You know, and the return on investment for $55,000 to $59,000 a year, The number one goal of a school as an educational facility should be educational opportunities for children. Now, I think we do a great job of providing other opportunities, and Mr. Springer, you and your staff provide other opportunities for kids for their interest in things such as sports. I'm sure we spend a lot more money than $60,000 a year on sports. When you start looking at those types of things, but for me, the number one goal should be that educational opportunities for kids. When we start looking at the time and the money and the FTE dollars, to be honest with you, Mr. Springer, I was told by somebody that the rules had changed as far as you still get funding for the FTE dollars if a kid leaves campus to do dual enrollment classes. And honestly, it was somebody working for your company, actually. So I don't know if that's in play. I heard that rule actually changed as of, I believe, July 1.
Yeah, I mean, share their name with me so I can get clarity on that. That would be ideal.
If not, there is the option, like a lot of other schools do, if kids do leave early to go, and let's say there's 15 kids that do half days, they take their Cambridge classes at the school and they leave early, or let's say it's 30 kids that do it. Well, now you have spots open where you can fill and bring in another 15 kids if 30 kids leave half day. You have that flexibility in your scheduling to make that work and be creative to bring in those same FTE dollars if that is true in that way. I know board member Sarah had a concern about the middle school kids, not being able to perform at that college level. And I know a lot of kids are not there. They're not going to do it. I don't think a lot of kids would take that opportunity, maybe once a decade. And if the board doesn't want to push for that, I'm okay with it. I don't want that to be the holdup. But I think for kids to be able to take extra classes, I mean, when you look at a student who comes from an economically challenged home in Coral Springs, I'd like to think everybody lives well off, but we know that's not true. And so for a kid to go ahead and go to college, then have to pay a lot of money to take art appreciation or one of those classes where they could take it, it's a simple college level class. They can take it through dual enrollment, not only to get into a higher educational facility, but also the cost savings. A lot of kids who do dual enrollment and have the opportunity to do it year round, they can graduate with an AA degree and save them and their families a lot of money. All those intro level classes and things that kids can take there. I think there's a lot of things to look at this, but I think for the cost of about $60,000 to give kids that opportunity that want to be challenged, and a lot of kids will work hard. And instead of going out and getting a job in high school to save money for college, they can go ahead and work their tails off a little bit at school instead of working their tails off at a job and make up that difference for college next year. The economics of that, to me, is pretty impressive. And the other thing is when you look at, college acceptance, what a lot of colleges look at is college acceptance. They base it off of classes that are available to you. So if you go to a school that offers dual enrollment, those classes are available to you. If you go to a school that doesn't offer it, it's not counted, right? However, we're only offering it currently during the summer and after ninth grade. And so for kids that have to work a summer job or do other things to contribute to their families and stuff, we're limiting them. For split homes, we're limiting some of those kids. And so for me, for a little bit extra funding there, I think, the number one goal of the school should be educational opportunities for students. So.
Mr. Chairman, may I?
Yeah.
When I think about our school, I've been here since 2004, which is about 17 years. I'm going into 17 years, and I've watched our school evolve from where we were to where we are. And one of the things about our school is that we're a school of choice. That's number one. Number two is that you can't be all things to all people, right? And even from business concept, you have your products. You know what you're offering, and this is what we offer. And I can tell you, when you think about dual enrollment, if you have to go during school time, number one is you really lose the feeling of what education is all about. Collaboration, camaraderie, friendships, working with your peers, knowing your teachers, benefiting from the community because you're out of school. you do it after school, what happens? You don't get to participate in after school activities, which also cuts into the development of an individual, a young person who needs that nurturing. And, you know, we can use COVID-19 for that example, for that matter. You know, the fact that isolating and being on your own is not in the best interest of the development of a child. So, you know, while we might want to offer this, for that reason, all the other reasons, I think we need the data. I mean, I don't know what the demand is for this for our kids at our school, but I can tell you that a lot of our kids come here because they're nurtured through athletics, performing arts, the multitude of programs that we offer, and the kind of community that we provide for their growth. And that's why we're in demand. So,
and I appreciate your comment. I appreciate your comments absolutely, it is a school choice. However, this is a school that the city of Coral Springs owns. And it's a matter of, you know, is this something that we want to see and meeting the needs of the students that choose the Coral Springs owned charter school? And I get it, you know, the thought of kids leaving campus and doing that, but, you know, kids do this at every other high school around. We have a contract from our Coral Springs Charter School with Broward College saying that we offer it from 6th to 12th grade, and we're not doing that right now. So I know there's a delicate balance through everything, but Board Member Simmons, you wanted to go, I see.
Yeah, there's a couple of things I'd want to say. So first, you know, kind of response to, you know, talk of like, you know, community and things of that nature. You know, everyone, I think on this call, if you're not aware, you know, my sister went to Coral Springs Charter. That's one of the reasons why we moved to Coral Springs. She went to Coral Springs Charter for her freshman and sophomore year. I'm not sure how we're going to address this, how we're going to work on this, but I know Mrs. Springer knows that it's something that's been not a concern of mine, but something where we can work on and improve in our school. Is our diversity and creating a culture in the school that nurtures, you know, students of different diverse backgrounds. And I'll leave it at that. I'll just say that, you know, my sister had a lot more identity issues while at Coral Springs Charter than when she, you know, went to another school. So that's that. If we're gonna talk about community and things of that nature, that's an area that we, I think, need to improve on greatly at our school. As far as this dual enrollment process goes, you know, for me personally, I think dual enrollment should be during the school year. I think that's just natural. I mean, it's every, you know, school does it and things of that nature. But from what I'm understanding from staff, and this meeting is getting a little lengthy, is that they'd rather keep it in the summer. And so I'm not going to sit here and try to force this on them if they don't want to do it, if they think it's going to mess with their identity and how they do things and all the stuff like that. I'm not gonna sit here and try to force that on them. I mean, do I think it would be better for it to be in the school year? Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, I don't think, you know, kids, in order to, you know, continue to progress in life and have this sterling academic, you know, achievement, you know, to spend their summers, you know, in dual enrollment, it's not necessarily right. But if the school is saying that this is what they've been doing and it's been helping, you know, it's worked for them and kids know this when they come here and things of that nature, well, then by all means continue. And that's my like only and final thoughts on this entire thing.
And Board Member Simmons, again, the cost that they're estimating is $55,000 to $60,000, or $55,000 to $59,000 to offer it during the school year. And I'm sure they can find a way to implement it and make it work. To do it so that way the summers are not necessarily, kids aren't overwhelmed and then have the ability to do some of those other things. So
yeah, and thank you. I guess, you know, final statement on my end as well is, you know, I'll certainly obviously take all of this under advisement since today is a discussion point. But, you know, I think we're kind of missing or leaving out and not reflecting back on the entire presentation, which was to show you that instead of we're doing all of this to provide them opportunity for college credit, opportunity for scholarship that exceeds, we're one of the highest schools when you look at percentage of Bright Future scholarship. So we're the top or one of the top schools in this county. We could stack us up against some of the other schools with regards to a Cambridge program and the offerings and the ability of our kids, the percentage of our students that are achieving a Bright Futures, a Cambridge diploma. So it wasn't to say that we don't find value in dual enrollment. It's just that we found what we believe is a better way and a better approach to wholeheartedly look at the whole child and provide them these offerings throughout their entire career at Coral Springs Charter School. So I appreciate and thank you, Commissioner Simmons. Thank you to all of our commission and Commissioner Vignola. And I absolutely will continue to take this under advisement and move forward. Should there be direction at the next board meeting that extends beyond that, but that's kind of where I'll leave it.
Board Member Carter.
Listening to everybody's comments, I feel, you know, both my daughters, well, one of them graduated charter and the other one left before graduation. Mrs. Hu said that the school is a school of choice. So these kids know what is available when they go to the school or when they sign up for the school. And the fact that we have a waiting list of like 2,000 kids, it says to me that what's in place is already good. And if it wasn't, I don't think you'd have that waiting list. And I understand where you're coming from on saying that, you know, for $60,000, they should have both options. But I really feel that there is already a lot in place that is a great offering for the students. Just my two cents.
And look, I agree, they do have a lot in place, but I think the minimal cost on this, and look, the other programs that they push, they do make a lot of money off of. You know, and there is a financial benefit to the school on it as well. But, you know, I mean, look, it is out of, I believe, somewhere around 40 high schools in Broward County. It's about a little bit above middle of the pack. I think it's the 18th or 19th ranked high school in the area, which is great. When you add in all the factors involved, they're not getting the same kids that might be going to Stoneman Douglas or might be going to Cypress Bay or some of these other schools, right? We have kids that are your average Coral Springs kids going in, and they do very well. But I think, you know, the simplicity of allowing kids to take dual enrollment is a very minimal ask over being able to do it just over the summer. Again, it's something that is a little bit more, and I understand people come here, whatever, but we make changes as a city all the time where people move to Coral Springs and we didn't have pickleball. You know, we didn't have other things that we continue to add and improve and try to get better at. You know, and I think just another offering to students, and not every student is going to take it. Not every student is going to take advantage of it. But for some families, it makes a difference, not only for where the kid's future ends up, but also economically, especially for some of your underprivileged kids that go to the charter school. And I think that's something that we should take into account here. So I know the mayor was in favor of allowing dual enrollment around a year. I know Board Member Simmons didn't want to force it on. Board Member Brooke, were you jumping on? I saw you on mute. Board Member Simmons was in favor. I didn't want to force it, it seemed like. Is that correct, Board Member Simmons? You think you'd rather it be offered, but you didn't want to force it? Is that what I understood?
Yeah, I mean, it just seems like it that the staff has made this presentation to show all the things they do to offer students many opportunities to obtain college credits, to, you know, do extra curricular academic, you know, programs and things of that nature. And so it just seems that, you know, this is not something that they're interested in doing. You know, obviously, as the principal, Mrs. Springer has to watch the dollars and stuff as well. And so it just seemed like they don't want to do it. So I'm not really in favor of you know, asking them to go to fall and spring for dual enrollment. You know, I think maybe in the future, if there are more parents that are clamoring for their students to dual enrollment during that time period, during the fall and spring, then, you know, let's revisit it then. But, you know, right now, just, you know, this meeting's getting very lengthy, man. And
I want to bring this in for a landing here. And then I'll ask Mr. Springer if he thinks, you know, with that $59,000 high estimate there, if you think it's something that you can offer out to the students at Coral Springs Charter School and make it work during the academic year as something that you can offer to your students.
Yeah, so based off of all the feedback, I obviously, you know, will continue to take this under advisement. I think it's more appropriate now, the way our protocol works with regards to these meetings, that we obviously pull this back and bring it to the school advisory board as well, and then have the school advisory board make an official recommendation to the board, so we can kind of obviously move it along that way, whereas it would come to a vote in that instance, if that's the instant. I you know, from what I'm hearing though, from some of the board members versus the others, you know, you go back to saying, you know, I'm Charter Schools USA, and Charter Schools USA, the reason, it's not that we don't want to do dual enrollment. I go back to saying this. We've put everything else in place so as to compensate for not having dual enrollment, whereas we could keep it in-house and we could stay on top of it and we could work with our kids and make sure that we offer them the appropriate guidance and opportunities. You keep bringing back to where it's providing those disadvantaged families. That's the whole point of Cambridge and a Cambridge diploma, and making sure that we're focused on Cambridge versus AP. Because statistically, if you ran the numbers versus ethnicity and race, you would realize that AP, quite honestly, was a much, much more aggressive program as far as the pass rates for minorities. Cambridge, definitely, I could probably tease out those numbers and show you a big difference. Whereas that we have, quite honestly, across the board, helped out so many more families with regards to financial assistance. So guys, this didn't start with me, but I am a firm believer in all of this. The reason why this was born decade ago, maybe 15 years ago, quite honestly, was because we felt that this was the right course for Coral Springs Charter. Those that have context to this, this was a big deal, implementing Cambridge into this school and sort of pulling back off of AP. That made a major shift, but I can assure you that there are thousands of families that have been impacted for the positive with regards to having Cambridge in our school. So I thank you guys. I really appreciate it. I'm so sorry. I feel like, you know, the meeting is, you know, getting beyond where it needs to be. Go ahead. Yeah.
My question isn't about Cambridge, and I know everyone enjoys Cambridge and likes the fact you have the Cambridge. I'm asking you, do you think there's a way to implement dual enrollment for the few kids that would be able to meet certain criteria at your school to allow them to take it during the school year?
I would like to bring this back to the advisory board and have them also weigh in on this topic.
All right. Board member Sarah, I believe you're unmuted.
Yeah, I also just wanted to remind us, we don't know truly if this is an FTE impact, which would reduce some funding to the school. So I'm in favor of letting Principal Springer bring it back to the advisory board and then make a recommendation to us as a board, whether or not they want to move forward with the idea. But I think that they've heard from us that, you know, some of us want them to explore it. So I got to run now. I apologize.
Any other comments by board members? Seeing none, we'll go ahead and adjourn this meeting. Thank you very much.
Great, thank you. Have a good one, everybody.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody.